I guess you know what two-factor authentication is, and there exist hardware tokens, for example YubiKeys or even your Google Authenticator on your phone, that can generate some code that you have to enter as additional proof when you want to get access to something. In this video, we will break a bad two-factor implementation and learn something about randomness. This example is a special challenge from the Riscure embedded hardware CTF. It actually has 400 points. That's an insane amount of points looking at the other challenges that I struggled with. But I still solved it. How? I solved the challenge in an unintended way, which coincidentally teaches you something about randomness. So let's head in. Twistword. A company is developing a new hardware two-factor authentication token for their employees as existing solutions are too expensive. The development team got many complaints about the slowness of the first version, and sometimes it was not even working. Most likely this is due to resource constraints of the used board. You managed to get one of the first boards with a new version of the system that was given to a few users to test if it has improved or not. However, is it also secure? Let's have a look at how this looks like on the board. When you connect to it, it says Twisted Inc. Secure Token Auth 2.0 Debug Build. Again, a message that they changed the algorithm, presumably made it now smaller and maybe more insecure. And then they ask for your two-factor authentication token. Now would be the moment you take your actual hardware token, generate the key and hand it in. If it matches the one the board calculated, you get in. But when you enter an incorrect one, it will tell you what the token was that it expected. That will be very helpful. So what can we do? Well, one of the first things that comes to mind is Mersenne Twister, because of the title, Twistword. The Mersenne Twister is a pseudo-random number generator. This means you give it some kind of seed and then it will scramble, flip, twist around the bits if you so wish, in order to create a new random state. Pseudo-random because it's not truly random. The same seed will produce the same values, but it's random enough for a lot of applications. And actually, with two-factor tokens, you want pseudo-random generators because the token generator as well as the service you want to access has to generate the same value so it can be compared, right? Also, when you scroll a bit further down, you can read that the algorithm in its native form is not cryptographically secure. The reason is that observing a sufficient number of iterations, 624 in the case of MT19937, since this is the size of the state vector from which the iterations are produced, allows one to predict all future iterations. So this Mersenne twister can be implemented with different values and parameters, and MT19937 defines one such implementation. I assume that for this challenge they used their own parameters, and you have to research how this attack works, how you can recover the state with enough samples. Another idea I had was that randomness is really difficult to do for computers. They are deterministic machines that just execute instructions. There's nothing random about them. So what you can do is you can try to collect entropy from different sources. On PCs, you often see that they tell you to move your mouse a lot because that movement is hard to predict. But what do you do on an Arduino? I assume one of the most likely ways would be to read an analog value from one of the pins. You know, reading a digital state would be a 0 or 1, but the Arduino can also read analog values from some pins. Well, it uses an ADC, analog to digital converter, to convert the voltage at one pin to the digital number. And if the pins are not connected, it could pick up interference from the background radio noise or something, and that's pretty random. So maybe you just have to pull all pins to ground, so make them zero. This way the initial random seed would always or often be the same. I thought that's a cool attack, but I felt like for 400 points, it would actually be harder than that. So I assumed it's about cracking the math of it. In order to do this, I first want to start with capturing a lot of tokens that I can later work with. The board is so nice to respond with the expected token. So I wrote two scripts. One would connect via serial and then just enter a wrong string and collect all the expected tokens, in the second script I wrote would always reset the serial connection, which resets the board and should newly initialize the PRNG. I figure that maybe I can learn something interesting about the initial states. And this data collection takes a while, especially the method with resetting the serial is very slow. So I let the data collection run overnight. The next morning I did a first quick check of the data. I didn't expect much because I was sure the real work now just started. Having to research how to recover the initial state and the data just helps testing. So I was casually looking over it if I noticed anything, and what the fuck? One of the files contained a duplicate value. This cannot be the case. These numbers are so big that a duplicate is highly unlikely. In fact, there were a couple of duplicates. Something is fishy. If this is about calculating the state of the PRNG and predicting the next value, this wouldn't happen. So I went the easy way. I modified my script to now just send this one duplicate value all the time. Also, a PRNG, like I said earlier, starts with the seed and then all the following values are predictable, if you know the implementation and parameters. This means when we got a duplicate value, the next expected token should have been also the same. So if I had saved the first two expected tokens after a board reset and I had encountered the same first token a second time, I could have just used the previous expected second token and win. So let's write a script for that and let it run overnight, and I'm sure I get another duplicate. This is the script I wrote. These functions, you know them already, just help me to interact with the board to read what text it sends me. The most important variable here is the list of tokens I encountered before. And at the beginning, it's empty. I also will write every token pair that I see to a file, so that when I interrupt the script, I can simply reload previous tokens I collected to not lose any data. And that's what I do here. So I rerun this a couple of times. It just adds the pairs I found before to the token list. Anyway, in an endless loop, I then create a fresh connection with the board. Then I wait until I get the text that I have to press enter. Then I read until it wants me to enter a token and send one of the duplicates I got earlier. Maybe I get lucky, but most of the times I won't. So then I read the token that was expected. Now I extract the token and check in my tokens list if I encountered the token before. If I did, I know what the next token will be. If it's new, I will just enter an empty token and get the next expected token, which I also extract and save it together with the first token in the tokens list. And down here, I have some fancy debug output. So theoretically, this should just work. It will just take a while. In my case, I think it ran for 3 hours or so, and then it found a duplicate. So my script sent the token it would expect afterwards, and surprise, surprise, it's the correct token and we get the flag. Now that was way easier than I thought. It was also not the intended solution, but it really highlights how hard it is to properly initialize the PRNG with a truly random seed in this small Arduino. I don't know how they tried to get this good random seed value, but it clearly didn't work. Randomness is not trivial for computers. Lessons learned. By the way, there was another small annoyance with this challenge. So when I found my first duplicate, it didn't work. I saw that I predicted the correct value because the second expected token was the same, but it didn't work. And it was an issue with the line endings. Let me explain what happened. It basically comes down to not being really user-friendly and flexible regarding input, but basically it expected 32 bytes of input followed by some kind of terminator, like when you press enter. Typically, that could be a new line, or a carriage return, or even a new line and a carriage return. So in this case, it only expected a carriage return. So, there are basically two stages when communicating, the buffer and the data that is actually handled. So at first, I sent a carriage return and a new line. So the buffer was filled with this data, and then the application read 32 bytes for the token and the carriage return, and that meant it was done. Now it asked for the second token. Now the new line was still in this buffer. It was never read by the application. So now I supplied the second token, which got written into the buffer. And when the application then read 32 bytes, the first byte was a new line. So obviously the expected token and the one I sent were not correct. This was really frustrating. But I got a hint regarding the issue, and then I was able to solve it at the end.